Greetings from Doordarshan. Take care holistically. We are back with another subject, diabetes. Indians are much more prone to get diabetes, specifically the Indian women. And that is going to be our subject today. And we are going to talk about diabetes, how to manage it holistically. We have experts with me to talk about the subject. On my left is Dr. Shikha Sharma, a medical doctor who started a career in wellness. Very few doctors will practice only wellness, and she is one of them, and she's going to talk a lot about wellness aspects of diabetes. And with me, I have Dr. Ambarish Mittal, who is an endocrinologist, and who is the chairman of the Division of Endocrinology and Diabetes. Welcome, Dr. Ambarish, and welcome, Dr. Shikha. And let's talk about the subject of diabetes. As I said, that diabetes is of concern to our country.
Yes.
I remember when I was doing my MBBS, we hardly used to see diabetes. Yes. In fact, we saw more type 1 insulin-dependent diabetes at that time than type 2 so-called insulin non-dependent or the adult onset type of diabetes. What is, first of all, just define what is diabetes and why diabetes is of concern to our country.
We all know diabetes translates into increased blood sugar. It increases blood glucose. We know that if you have a fasting blood glucose of more than 126 and a postprandial more than 200, you are diabetic. If you are between 100 and 125 fasting or between 140 and 200 postprandial, then you are classified as a pre-diabetic. But diabetes is not just blood glucose. Diabetes is a syndrome which comprises elevated blood sugar, but also has a lot of other ramifications and connotations. For example, association of diabetes with blood pressure, association of diabetes with cholesterol problems, association of diabetes with heart disease. So it's a whole conundrum that includes obesity, diabetes, metabolic abnormalities, including blood pressure, cholesterol problems, the whole thing combines into one. So when we look at a diabetic, we are not just looking at his blood sugar or her blood sugar. We are looking at the metabolic picture in total, and we have to manage all of it.
And that's the reason the phrase came ABC. You manage A for A1C, B for blood pressure, and C for cholesterol.
Absolutely, and we'll come back to that. So why is it of concern? You know, why should we worry about diabetes? We worry about a disease when it's common. We don't worry so much about common cold though. We worry about a disease when it's serious, and diabetes can have serious ramifications in terms of the complications it produces. And we are concerned about a disease when we can do something about it. So diabetes fulfills all the criterion for a public health problem. It's hugely common. Right now, for example, in India, the crude incidence of diabetes in adults is about 8% of adult population. But if you move to the cities, to the metros, for example, it goes up to 15-16% of adult population. That is huge, right? And it goes up from villages to adults, to metros. From village to small town, it doubles 4 to 8, and from small town to big town, 8 to 16%. So there is a whole spectrum. So diabetes is very common in India. Diabetes has serious ramifications. You could get kidney involvement, you could get eye involvement, you could get heart involvement, your feet, your nerves. So it is very important. But the most important thing about diabetes is that we can do something about it. So even though all this picture looks grim, you know, the whole world is reeling under a diabetes epidemic, Asia particularly more so. But it's also important to remember that if you diagnose diabetes in time, and if you take adequate preventive and therapeutic steps, you can save yourself of almost all the complications of diabetes.
So Shikha, everybody says, I am diabetic because I can't choose my parents. Everybody blames it to the genetics. they don't want to blame it to obesity, they don't want to blame it to a lifestyle. They say, oh, no, my mother had diabetes, so I'm going to get it, I can't help it. What has changed in the last 100, 200 years that diabetes is becoming, that India is going to be the diabetic capital of the world? What has changed?
Actually, a lot of things have changed. Firstly, if I address your first question, that if diabetic is genetic, that means are we like, are we supposed to get it, and is it 100% that we're going to get it? No, because a lot of choices, because genes only plays a particular role, and after that your conscious activities, what you actually do, that has a very important and profound role in your health. So a child of a non-diabetic can lead an extremely healthy life and not get diabetic. So it's in our hands, and genes is only a kind of one of the things which might happen. It's only a potential. Second thing is that what has changed in so many thousands of years? What has really changed is, A, the kind of diet we are having. It's completely become refined. Like, for example, we were not supposed to be eating foods which were processed to this degree. Like we mentioned, like ganna, then gur, you have gur, then you have refined gur, then you have white sugar.
And that brown sugar and then white sugar.
Then white sugar. So in this entire processing, what is left? There's a lot of chemicals. There are a lot of toxins which are involved for cleaning, for, you know, changing the color. And everything which was good in that ganna, which would be iron, which could be B complex, is completely thrown out.
So one is diet, and that too, more and more of refined.
Refined. So what happens when we take a refined diet? We actually, A, the nourishing portion is thrown out. All the minerals which digest the food and all the vitamins which digest the food is thrown out. And we are left with a very highly potent food, which has an immense cascade or like a huge impact on our bodies. That's one. Second thing is, what has also happened is that our normal life, which was like walking around, has completely changed. So human beings were designed to walk, and now we are just completely sedentary.
So remote control TV, yes. We want lifts, we want cordless phones, yes. We want mobile phones, we don't want to walk.
Yes. And the third thing what has happened, that because we, in metros particularly, we are living very close. So in a way, we are like, you know, like laboratory. You just put in a lot of animals together in a small cage. So when we are just put in together, we are having a lot of stress. And stress is because we're competing constantly for the same kind of things, which could be traffic, which could be other issues. So all these things together with a bad diet.
But she says stress. Stress was there in our ancient era also.
Yes.
The stress was there even in that time. Why diabetes was not there?
I'll use a contemporary analogy. Look at. The genes of Indians, they are the same, right? Whether you live in the village, we all came from villages originally. But the diabetes in villages is 1/4 of the diabetes in large cities. So the genes make us predisposed or prone to it. So you're standing on a slope. But whether you go down the slope or not depends on what you do. So I think we need to be very clear. There's so much talk about genetics. If you look at pure genetics, I don't think Indians are hugely more susceptible than others. They're somewhat equivalent to many other populations. It is a changing lifestyle that is making South Asians so much more susceptible. I think in the past, I completely agree with Shikha, one huge change has been physical activity. What was part of life, now you can't take out time for that. You talk to everybody, all my patients say, I have no time for exercise. Right? Now, exercise was part, if you had to drink some water, you had to go to the well and pull out that water, so that effort was involved in even that. Now everything is on your plate.
What is that lifestyle causing in the body? Is it insulin resistance? Is it hyperinsulinemia?
Yes. Lifestyle, if you look at it in a very simplistic way, what does lifestyle do? It basically changes our body composition. So what happens is that we have, for the same proportion of our body weight, we have more fat and less muscle. So less muscle mass and more fat mass. And this, as you know, is bad fat, because it gets collected around the tummy. That's typical of South Asians. And this bad fat actually releases a whole lot of nasty chemicals and toxins in the body that makes us prone to diabetes, blood pressure, cholesterol problems.
But invariably, it will be linked to somewhere insulin resistance,
yes,
and high,
yes,
levels of insulin,
absolutely,
in the body and high sugar
simultaneously. Yes, yes, yes.
So what are these, when we talk about refined carbohydrates,
yes,
they are responsible for hyperinsulinemia?
Well, what happens when you have refined carbohydrate, for example, one of the things that happens...
White rice,
yeah,
white maida,
yeah,
and white sugar.
So high glycemic index.
Yes.
So they get absorbed fast, in a very simplistic way again. And when you get when anything gets absorbed fast, it triggers a fast insulin response. So there is a surge of insulin from the pancreas. And then it's supposed to die out quickly. Sometimes it does die out quickly, sometimes it's not so well coordinated. So if your food is getting absorbed slowly, if the same carbs are mixed with a lot of fiber and they are getting absorbed slowly, you don't get that sudden surge of insulin. You're not pushing your pancreas all the time. You're doing it much more physiologically. And that's why these ups and downs that happen with highly refined food in the glucose and consequently in the insulin levels is what produces a state of pancreatic, you know, toxicity or injury. And that's why the pancreas produces more and more insulin, overcome the insulin resistance, and that's how it goes on.
Now, why I'm talking specifically this question is that in our ancient mythological rituals, if you read all our Vedic sciences, very clearly it is written that we, the Asians, specifically the Indians, should fast once in a week, one extra fast once in a month, then 18 days fast in terms of two Navratra. That means you must fast for 80 days in a year, and the fast is very, very, very simple. Half the food eaten the other days, no cereals on that day. That means our Shastra have been saying that if you eat cereals every day, 365 days in a year, you are going to suffer from a disease called Anna Dosh, which probably they meant was diabetes.
I think what has happened over the years, and I think that's a very, very interesting interpretation, is that carbohydrate-based diets were a result of cultivation, and they were a way to prevent starvation. You know, that was the cheapest way to prevent. So what this kind of cereal-based diets did was that it saved large, you know, tracts of humanity from starvation. But actually, in the long run, they may not be healthy and produce a lot of chronic disorders. So your interpretation of that is very fascinating.
So I'm going to come back to one more thing. Again, I go back to mythology. And I'm going to give one prayer, which probably all of us have.
Yes, in school.
We have been reading about. And that prayer is Gajananan Bhut Ganadi Sevitam Kapith Jambu Phal Charu Bhakshanam Uma Sutam Shok Vinashikarakam Namami Vigneshwar Pad Pankajam. And if I analyze the prayer, it talks about Gajananam Bhut Ganadi Sevitam, ki whatever we offer to Ganesh, we should offer to ourselves. And then it talks about Kapith Jambu. Kapith is a Keth Phal, and Jambu is Jamun. Fruit, Phal Charu Bhakshanam, that means you should offer him and offer yourself. And if you talk to an Ayurvedic doctor, Keth, Jamun, Bail, all are anti-diabetic properties. Yes. And then we talk about the puffed rice. Compared to the white rice, puffed rice has low glycemic index, yes, and you eat a less quantity. Does it mean that at that time in ancient era, Rishi Munis knew how to prevent metabolic syndrome?
What this tells us, and what Ayurveda tells us a lot, is that, you know, if you follow particular kinds of diet, you can reduce your risk of metabolic syndrome very substantially. Sometimes people translate that directly into therapy. So my concern is that it may not apply so directly to therapy.
Adjunct.
Yes, but it will definitely be an adjunct. And I'm pretty sure all the stuff you read in Asian literature, Indian and some in Chinese, and you actually do find that particular kinds of lifestyle prevented long-term chronic disorders, the kind we discussed. So enough antioxidants, fruits, enough fiber, you know, and certain things which have little insulin sensitizing properties like jamun and others. So I think that's how they worked on it.
Shikha, in Ayurveda we talk about six tastes: sweet, sour and salt, astringent, pungent and bitter. And we know that sweet, sour and salt increases kapha, and kapha is linked with diabetes. And bitter, astringent and pungent are supposed to reduce diabetes. And it is also said that every sweet item must be neutralized with a bitter item. Therefore, you should not eat aloo, potato, and to potato you mix methi. So,
right.
And for every sweet item, add a bitter item. Is it? Yeah. Do you also follow the same?
No. In fact, if you really see, you know, a lot of food comes naturally in the right proportion. Like, for example, if we look at the refining culture, a lot of times it's said that this has whey protein, or this has this particular protein. It has been taken away from the context, because when a particular fruit or vegetable comes in its natural composition, or the way it's been made by nature, manufactured by nature, it has all those things in it. So what one thing which I want to, like two things I want to touch upon is, one thing is that food combination itself, Ayurveda has a whole chapter devoted to correct food combinations. Second thing is that Ayurveda also talks about thinking, having things in its natural form in daily life. Now, what is happening is we are sitting today in a place where a lot of people, you know, they'll eat a lot of sweet, and then they'll go and have a lot of Ayurvedic churan much above the dose, thinking, oh, this is over the counter, so it doesn't matter. And at the same time, they try to balance it by thinking that they're somehow balancing the you know, the taste. So what I want to say is that A, you cannot do that. So suppose if I'm a diabetic and I want to have two rasgullas, and then I say, ki, I'll have this neem ka churan, and I'll have it instead of like little bit, I'll have it in five times the amount because it's like a medication. That doesn't work.
But potato with green peas, that yes. is alu matar,
yes.
Versus potato methi.
Potato methi is much better.
Invariably will be much
absolutely,
better.
And absolutely.
And another thing is that alu methi is better, but not methi alu. Because in methi alu, you are yes. neutralizing the benefits of methi by adding alu into it.
Yes, 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 yes.
You
yes,
must
yes,
neutralize
yes.
alu
yes.
with methi, but not neutralize methi with alu, because yes. methi in any way is good for the health.
And it will be interested to know that, you know, when they did a research in US and they asked kids, are you eating a lot of vegetables? They said, yes, we are eating vegetables every day. So they were very surprised, and they discovered it was only potato they're talking about, yes, as a vegetable.
Yes, yes.
So there was no vegetable.
Yeah. So anything under the ground has is not good for the diabetic.
Yes,
patients.
And also the kids are not really eating all those greens. You know what we're talking about healthy, they're not really eating them. So in our daily life.
What about when we talk about sugar? We talk about anything which ends with O's, sucrose,
yes.
maltose,
yes.
galactose,
yes.
glucose,
yes.
everything is sugar.
Yes.
And what about the artificial sugar? Because Ayurveda says no to artificial sugar. And there are later studies who are coming. They say it is not the sugar, but actually the taste, the sugar as a taste which increases metabolic syndrome. What about the latest about sugar substitutes?
I think with sugar substitutes, there is a whole amount of controversy. There's no doubt about that. The studies both ways. There are two things. One is, if you can avoid sweets without taking sugar sweeteners, nothing like it. I mean, there's no question about that, right? But if you have a craving for sweet, and if you are unable to avoid sweets, you know, because you really feel distressed or stressed out by that, there is nothing wrong in small amounts of artificial sweetener. Even little bit of sweet is not prohibited for diabetics. So that's an important point, if put in the proper context.
If I say that you can have good, but probably prefer good, if you want to have a sweet, then prefer good over
yeah,
so-called refined sugar.
Yeah, but it has to fit into the overall diet plan for that day. And if you are allowed some sweet, everyone is allowed a little bit of sweet. And that, of course, good has other properties. Chini has no properties. So it's good to have good as compared to chini. But it's not that good is safe for diabetics. You know, we have to balance it out.
Absolutely.
In the total diet plan. So I think the as far as sweeteners go, we should avoid excess. If we have a sweet tooth and we really have a craving, it's okay to use stevia or even aspartame. But in limited amounts, maybe a couple of pills a day or something is not going to harm you.
Many people will come back and say, I want a salted biscuit.
Yes.
I mean, salted biscuit is going
yes.
to have sugar. Because
yeah.
you can't have a
yeah.
biscuit
yeah.
without sugar.
I think one of the biggest culprits, Shikha pointed it out.
But they start thinking, I'm going to take a salt.
Yeah. Cookies and biscuits are some of the biggest culprits. All our snacks, whether we use Indian or Western snacks, most of them are unhealthy. That's the problem. We don't have fruits as snacks. We think we have namkeen, we have salted stuff. But all of that is fried, either
or
the base is carb. The base is carb. All biscuits, cookies are made
yes.
of carb. Not only that, many of them have trans fats, as you will know better.
Yes, yes.
I mean, you know, so there's a big issue about having just a few biscuits with tea, that those biscuits are a problem. So I think we need to be careful about apparently salted stuff, which is actually made of carbohydrate and often deep fried.
Shikhar, Amrish very rightly talked about trans fat. And we know that it's a major culprit in India, because when you eat out, it's trans fat. You go to a marriage, it's trans fat. And it's tasty. Its shelf life is more. And
life.
It increases bad cholesterol, reduces good cholesterol. What to do? How do we convince people that trans fat is bad for the health?
See, first thing, you know, which is very important to share is that trans fat is an alien. It's an alien to our body. And our body will throw a reaction. And that reaction will affect our heart, it will affect our blood vessels, it will affect our liver very badly, because that's where the metabolism is happening. And the more and more we are having these alien substances, our body is overwhelmed. I mean, it's struggling to have a normal function. And therefore, trans fat is not your regular ghee, trans fat is not your regular oil. Trans fat is something which the structure is changed. So if suppose something was normal and it could pass through some your blood vessel or it could pass through a particular cell, trans fat is abnormal, so it will not go through and it will create a toxic reaction throughout the body. And that is the reason that a little natural fat may not damage you as much as a trans fat will, because it's completely alien to your body. And that's the reason that people have to understand that trans fat doesn't come like, people might tell you that okay, we're not buying vanaspati ghee, we're not buying those kind of things, but people don't realize all biscuits are trans fats, all kids
pizza,
food,
pizza, burger, everything is trans fat.
Yeah, all the kids
food. Anything which is tasty is trans fat. It can't.
All fast food.
If you're going to say that, oh my God, if I wanted to eat this food, I would have rather had it at home.
Yes.
So that means they are going out only to eat trans fat.
Absolutely.
It's better to eat desi ghee there. Yes. Ask them to give me a desi ghee ka paratha.
Absolutely. And my main concern is the kids, because the kids, we are constantly overfeeding them trans fats, and I won't be surprised if we don't do something soon. All these kids are going to become diabetic very soon. And that's the reason trans fat needs a serious,
When we talk about diet, then we do talk about karela, methi, jamun, and we talk about sadabahar ki leaves. Yes. We talk about neem.
Yes.
They all are bitter.
Yes.
And I mean, do they? How much blood sugar they can actually reduce?
Well, the concept of bitters is been very ancient, and it's always been there in all sciences. So bitters have been there, and they are important.
In fact, all anti-diabetic drugs, even allopathic, are bitter.
Yes. I mean, metformin is a classic. So bitters example. I think it's a function of their improving possibly insulin resistance to some extent, but I don't know if that is unequivocally proven. But I think that consumption of these healthy food items on a regular basis will almost certainly delay
asking specifically this question is because we say that most of the allopathic drugs will reduce your blood sugar between 60 to 100. Mm.
Right.
60, 70, 100.
Right.
So I am trying to say if you need a reduction of 200, even this therapy, so-called diet therapy, will also reduce it by maximum by 60. So therefore, they cannot take care of a sugar of 400 or 300.
Correct. So absolutely. And the advantage with allopathy, of course, is that we can play around much more. It is more quantified. And we can use multiple drugs, judicious combination of drugs. So dietary measures will always be good. No one can say no to them.
And another thing which happens is a patient will come back to you and he'll say, he'll go back to Ayurveda next time, he'll go to homeopath next time, then he goes back to naturopath next time, then he comes back to you.
I think this is a particularly Asian Indian problem. As far as I am concerned, my answer to my patients is very straightforward. Show me good results. Show me good blood glucose values, HbA1c values, good lipids, weight loss. I don't care what drug you're having. So if you're having indigenous remedies, just diet-based remedies, remedies that Dr. Agarwal talked about, and if you're maintaining these parameters, I'm perfectly happy not to give you any medication. The problem is that sometimes patients don't check. They're feeling good and they think they're doing well, and that's a big trap. So we need to avoid that, need to be careful. And if you're doing well with these forms of therapy, perfect. Why not?
What about exercise, Shikha? How much exercise one should do?
In fact, that's very interesting because, many of the diabetics we talk to, they come back and they say, look, we are going to control our diet and we're
going to exercise a lot.
No, we have already got the medication. So what's the point of exercises? What's the point, So then you have to explain it to them that, look, diabetes, if the blood sugar control is not the only thing, your leg circulation, your feet circulation, insulin control will only come through exercise. You cannot train your insulin for better controls if you're not exercising, because over the years our insulin controls on our own body starts becoming very sluggish. And that's the reason that if you don't want, even if with this kind of diet and this kind of medication, you'll keep going down the hill if there is no exercise. So that's the third treatment modality people don't want to do.
Alcohol. We talk about alcohol, and I was reading a recent study and which talked about that 18 ml of alcohol, 6 grams of alcohol is medically is a drug. More than 18 ml, up to 2 packs, that is 80 ml, American pack, is not going to harm you, and more than 80 ml is going to harm you.
Yeah.
And so the limit is 80 ml in a day and 80 grams in a week. But if you want to use it as a medicine, it should not be more than 18 ml.
Right. I think the conventional cutoff by all the associations is actually 60 ml per day. So we should by and large use a cutoff 60 ml of whiskey or equivalent, which is roughly equal to one large serving of any kind of alcohol. In fact, some smaller built people, especially women, for example, they probably for them 30 ml cutoff is more appropriate.
Half the dose of women.
So 30 to 60 ml, depending on your race and gender, etc.
But only for those who drink, not for somebody to start.
No, of course not. We're not recommending alcohol. We're just saying that you can have this much. Now, a typical example in alcohol, which is very important, and particularly in some Asian cultures, no alcohol 5 days a week and a binge on Saturday. You know,
that's bad.
Absolutely
obviously,
no.
Obviously that.
You can't have 300 ml on Saturday versus 60 ml every day. Okay. So
binge,
I think that's
binge alcoholism really can kill. That we all know. Yeah. And smoking, because smoking is something which diabetes cannot afford to have.
Just I'll complete one line about alcohol. Remember about alcohol that it can do both things. Alcohol can raise your sugar, but it can cause fatally low blood sugar also. A binge, since we left it at binge. And that's good to know, with patients say, when I have alcohol, my sugar is lower. And this happens. And actually, you may be getting very low sugars in the night, which can be really dangerous. So alcohol is not okay. Smoking, of course, smoking and risk of diabetes is still debated. There is some data to suggest that smoking per se may increase risk of diabetes. But smoking has a huge impact on complications of diabetes. So smoking has
certain
an
death.
Added
but
risk factor.
Chances of sudden death will certain be higher if you...
Your feet, vascular, your heart, lungs. So smoking is an added risk. It's like you're just adding something on to already
speak
the risk
about stress.
See, stress on a couple of issues. First is, what stress does is it basically incapacitates a person to take positive action. And that is my definition of stress. So despite the fact that, you know, Dr. Amrish will advise a patient that these are the things which are required for you, I would advise a patient. But because he's just so incapacitated, he will not take any positive corrective action. And plus, sustenance is also tough for him. So that's the reason stress management techniques have to be included.
So yoga, pranayama, meditation always helps.
In fact, I want to add one more thing. When we tell people to meditate, they say meditation is too tough, we can't deal with it. But meditation is not, it's not about religion. It's basically just relaxing and breathing.
It's a shift from sympathetic to parasympathetic.
Absolutely,
mode.
Absolutely.
It's a way of relaxation.
I think it's really important what Shikha said, and I'll reiterate that point, that people who are stressed or anxious or depressed will not be able to follow lifestyle measures. So one is, the stress itself increases insulin resistance and all those problems. But by preventing a person from following a good lifestyle, it's a big deterrent. A depressed person will not go for exercise every morning. So I think this is a very, very important point.
If diabetes is a lifestyle disorder, so we should be able to reverse it. We should be able to cure it. If not medically,
yes.
Can surgically something be done?
Okay, first, it is a lifestyle disorder, but it's not only a lifestyle
disorder.
And in prevention, lifestyle plays a huge role. In better management, better long-term outcomes, it plays a huge role. So, but later on, as disease advances, lifestyle alone may not be enough, as you very well know. About surgery, you said. What about something drastic, radical, fix the damn thing once and for all? Surgery for diabetes is still developing. Surgery for obesity is pretty well established now. And remember that some studies have shown 75% to 80% of diabetes would disappear if people were not obese.
So if you are obese and diabetic,
correct, then
morbid obesity,
yes,
and
yes,
diabetes,
yes,
one can take advantage
that.
Of
yes.
Get rid of obesity, yeah, and diabetes together. Thank you, Dr. Amrish, and thank you, Dr. Shikha. Now we are going to show you some yoga and pranayam. As Shikha said, that yoga, pranayam and meditation are good for health. They are good for relieving stress on the body. And the asana we are going to show you is Manduk asana, which is done in sitting in Padmasana or in Vrajasana posture. And with that, you bend forward and put your two hands, and then you compress your abdominal area. As far as yogic science is concerned, we have seven chakra, and the chakra which is in the celiac area, near the navi area, umbilical area, is the area. All those asanas which compress or stretch this area are good for diabetes. That's all for today. Thank you. Take care holistically. We'll be back with another subject next time. Thank you.